In this session, we'll be writing a program which can add two numbers. So before getting started with that, let us see some basic terminologies that are used in Java. So the first thing is keywords. Now the question is, what are keywords? Keywords are your reserved words that has some special meaning to the Java compiler. So these are the set of keywords that are reserved in Java, and that has a special meaning to the Java compiler. So you can see lots of keyword here: byte, break, double. So by the end of the course, we'll be using almost all the keywords, and slowly you will understand the meaning of each and every keyword here. So every keyword has a specific meaning to the Java compiler, and we can use the keyword in our program only for the purpose for which it has been defined, right? Now the next term that I want to explain it to you is identifiers. Now what are identifiers? So in programming languages, identifiers are names used to identify a variable. It is used to identify a variable, methods, or any other entity or other entities that you are using in your program. Just like you are a human being and you have a individual name, using your name, it is right, your name is used for identifying you. So if I just call your name, then you will respond, right? So that is, your name is just like the identifier. Now there are certain rules for naming the identifier in Java. So these are the rules. So first rule is that the name that you want to use must be a letter which includes both upper and lowercase letters. It can be a letter or it can be underscore sign, like this. This is your underscore sign, or digit. So you can use the digits 0 to 9. So your identifier name can contain only letter that includes your both upper and lowercase letters, underscore and digits, and nothing out of this. You cannot use anything out of this. You cannot use special characters like your hash symbol or at the rate symbol. Sorry, I forgot one thing. You can even use the dollar symbol in Java, right? So your identifier names can contain letter, both upper and lowercase, underscore, digits, and your dollar symbol, right? Then your identifier name, it cannot start with, right? It cannot start with a digit. So if you try to write something like this, let's say 9PT, then this is invalid identifier name. You cannot write your identifier name like this, right? So some of the valid identifier names that you must know, some examples, like here I can write TMP temp. This is valid because it contains only letters. Then it can have uppercase letters as well. Now here one important thing: the names that are used in Java are case sensitive. So Java is a case sensitive language. What is the meaning of case sensitive? The temp, right, which contains all lowercase letters, and this temp where the T is only here your uppercase letter. So these two names are distinct in Java. So that is the meaning of case sensitivity. That means these two things are different. So this is also a valid identifier that you can see here, temp. Then we can write something like this, let's say fit 9. This is also valid. Then you can have write this sum underscore of underscore, let's say PT, sum of PT, right? Then you can have like this also, sum capital OF. So these are some of the examples of your valid identifiers, and this is invalid identifier because your names cannot start with digit. And then whatever identifiers that you are using, they are case sensitive in Java, right? Then it cannot be a keyword. It cannot be a keyword. That means you cannot use your identifier name from any of these reserved words, because reserved words have special meaning to the compiler, right? So Java doesn't allows you to use any keyword out of this, right? Let's say if it is very necessary for you that you have to use this else word, so in that case you can just use this else with capital letter. So this else is not a reserved word. This else is reserved word, but this else is not reserved word because here you have changed the case, right? So these are the rules that you must keep in mind while naming identifiers. Now let's move ahead for writing the program for adding two numbers. So for that, what I will do, I'll write n1 equals 9. So we need something called variables in Java in order to store data. So variables are just like containers which can store some data, right? So if I write here n1 equals 9, so what is going to happen? What do you think? This value 9, will it get stored within this n1? Let us try to run this and let's see what is the output of this. So it says that Java cannot find symbol the variable n1. So this variable n1, it is not able to understand that what type of data it is storing, right? So in order to understand, in order to explain Java that what kind of data you want to store, you need to mention something called data type of this variable. So you need to write here int. So int is the data type of the variable. So this, right, I mentioned two things here. That is, what is a variable? Variable is just a container which can store some data, right? So whatever data you are going to store, that is all going to get stored in the memory, and whatever data you are storing all gets converted into binary, because you know that end of the day your computer understands only binary language, right? And the next term that I said is something called data type. Data type. So data type determines that what kind of data your variable can store, first thing. Second thing is how many number of bytes are going to be occupied in the main memory, and third thing is that what set of operations are allowed on the variable. Now whatever this line number 7 I've written here, what is the meaning of this? First of all, this n1 is the name of the variable, and to remind you again, variable names must be valid identifiers, right? So whatever rules you just saw right now for naming the identifier, you should keep those in mind while naming the variable, because variable names are also identifier, right? Then the type of this variable is determined by this keyword. This is a reserved word, right? So this says the Java compiler that there is a variable n1 whose data type is int, and please allow only integers to be stored within this variable n1. So that is it. So we can store some range of numbers, that is positive to negative, within this container, this variable n1. So that's it. So this is called your variable definition, right? That means when you are assigning some value to the variable during the variable declaration time, this is called a variable definition. Similarly, we can just have other variables, int n2 equals, let's say 10, and I want to have the sum of these two numbers. So I can write here int sum equals n1 plus n2. So what will happen in this line number 9 is that, first of all, a variable will get created, sum, whose name will be sum, its data type will be int, and then the content of n1 and n2 will be taken together. After addition, whatever sum is produced will be produced, will get stored within this variable sum. And finally, we want to print the value of this sum. So if I write here like this and try to execute it, let me run it. All right. So you see what is happening here? I did not get my sum that I was expecting, that 9 plus 10, 19 would be printed, but it has printed the sum exactly. So what is happening here? Whenever you write something, some set of characters within double quotes, then it treats it like a string, yes or no? So here I need the value of sum, not exactly this sum, right? So whenever you need to print the value of the variable, you should write the variable name without double quotes. So please keep this in mind that whenever you need to print the value of a variable, write the name of the variable without double quotes. So now if I run it, you will see the output which you are expecting. So this is 19. Now what if I want to print the output something like this, that sum of n1, that is your 9 and 10, is 19. If I want to have the output like this, let's see how can we achieve it. So in that case, I will write here sum of, then I'll write here n1, and then I'll write here and, then I will be writing here n2 is sum, So what do you think is going to happen? So if I just try to run this, it is going to throw error. So whenever you want to attach string with variables, you need to use this plus symbol, right? Whenever you need to attach strings with variables, you need to use the plus symbol. So this acts like a concatenation operator. That means it joins the string with the variables. Now if I run it, you will get the output as you are thinking, as you are expecting. So sum of, right, I need to give space here, sum of n1, the value of n1 got printed. Did you observe here? This sum of got printed as it is exactly, then value of n1, that is 9, got printed, then space and space, after that the value of n2 got printed, and then space again, is space again, and then this sum variable. So try to take some time and digest this fact, that how can we attach strings with variable names. So whenever you want to print string as it is, then just within double quotes you write the characters, and whenever you need to print the variables, just write the variable name without double quotes, and whenever you need to attach the strings with variable names, then we use this plus symbol there. So we have achieved our target of adding two numbers. Now what if I need to, so basically what happens, your integer occupies 4 bytes in memory, right? Now what if I want to store larger numbers, very large integers? So there are many variations of integers that is provided by the Java language. If you want to store limited range of integers, for that we have byte data type which can store limited range of integers, right? So let me just focus on this part. So byte occupies 1 byte in memory. Your integer occupies 4 bytes in memory. This is fixed in Java actually. Then if you want to use slightly larger range of integers as compared to byte, then we have short data type. Short can store slightly again larger range as compared to byte. Short occupies 2 bytes in memory. Then we have int, the most commonly used int I. And if you want to store more larger range of numbers, then we use long data type. So long, the long data type occupies 8 bytes in memory. So these are the 4 variations for storing integers in Java programming language. Now let us say if you want to write many variables of same data type, for that we use this comma operator. So B, comma C, comma D. So if you see this B, C, D variables, they all have same data type, that is byte. You can just give any value here using this assignment operator 3, then you can just provide value of C as well, right? And whenever you do not initialize, right, this step of assigning a value during the definition of the variable is called your initialization of the variable, right? So if this D is not initialized, then it gets the default value. So by default, the default value of this byte, short, int, long is your 0, right? So this was all about your integer data type. Now what if you want to store numbers like 2.3 or the value of pi, all the real value numbers, right? So for that we have float data type. So float f equals 3.43. So whenever you write this floating point numbers, just append f, the letter f here, right? I'll explain you why we need to do this in some other videos. So if you want to store larger precision numbers as compared to float, then we have double data type. So float and double are the two different data types which are used for storing real valued numbers. So if you want to store larger precision as compared to float, then we can use this double data type. So in order to deal with integers, we have byte, short, int, long, and in order to deal with the decimal numbers, the real valued numbers, we have float and double. So depending upon the precision, you can use anything that you like. So basically whenever you are dealing with mathematical, the programs that are dealing with mathematical calculations, I always recommend that you should be using the double data type. Now what are the other data types that are provided? In order to store characters, we have char data type, char C, and in Java programming language, char occupies 2 bytes of memory, and we represent characters within this single quotes, right? So if you try to write 2 characters within this single quote, then it is going to give an error, that is too many characters in character literal. This is invalid actually. So whenever you are writing character, make sure that within your single quote you are writing only one single character, right? So your character occupies 2 bytes of memory in Java. Then we have Boolean. This Boolean data type can represent only 2 values, that is either true or it can be false. So these are actually your basic data types. That means these are inherently supported by the Java programming language. That is your these integer data types, then this float and double, and this character and this Boolean. And now the last data type that I would like to discuss here is the string data type. So here if you see, the string is capital, this S is capital here, right? That is your uppercase letter. So string S equals, I can write here, this is a string, right? So the set of characters that we write within the string, that we write within this double quote, is your string. So if you just want to print the value of this string, then you can just write system.out.print here S. So if you try to run this, then you can see this, the content of this is a string, gets printed. So this is a string, got printed as it is. So this is your string data type, right? So in this video we saw that what are keywords in Java, what are identifiers, variables, data types. Then we also saw that how can we add 2 numbers. So these data types are actually basic data types, and the other name of these basic data types in Java is also known as primitive data types. So for integers we have byte, short, int, long, having, occupying various different sizes, different number of bytes in memory. Then we have this float and double for representing real numbers, right? Then we have character data type in order to represent characters. Then Boolean data type for representing true or false. And then lastly we saw string. So this was all about the keyword, identifiers, variables, data types in Java. Thank you for watching.